I have to admit that in our Arts Academy in the 70s, painting was really the lowest form you could do. I mean, I was very ashamed of doing that because the painters were really the most uninteresting people. And the paintings done there was also, not at all of, so I was fascinated by the photographers and by the filmmakers, and I thought indeed that film was the, I still think so a little bit, but okay, we try to give the other art forms also some credit, but that for me then film really was the art form of the 20th century. I grew up in South Africa on a farm in a small place called Kuilsrivier. The big event, if you went somewhere, was not to a museum, not to anything else, but was to the drive-in theater. And my father, when he was still alive, he died when I was 12, going on to 13, he actually was not such a big movie fan. So he would put the wine in the back of the car and take a pillow with, and he would mostly fall asleep in the movies, but he drove the car. And in the apartheid time, black and white people were not allowed to go together to the movies. But if someone looked after the children, if it was a female person of a different color, there was sometimes made an exception. And we had someone on the farm, a much older gentleman who was there for many years, and as children we once dressed him up as a woman to go with to the movies. So it is a strange combination of things that, so the movies are not just a film reel, but it's, and also the censorship. I remember in South Africa you always had quite some censorship. And I saw Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, also in this drive-in theater. That was unusual. And I think then the age limit was 4 to 16. And I was about 12, and they asked where you had to pay, is this child the right age? And my mother said, almost. And I remember I did not understand anything of this movie because I didn't then know Tennessee Williams, and I also didn't then know anything about homosexuality, and I also didn't know that in those days you were not supposed to show it properly. So it was, so I didn't quite know what it was that you weren't supposed to see, because you didn't really see anything happening in the movie. And at the university, you had a film society. And the film society, they got around a lot of the censorship laws and around also some of the political laws. And there, I for the first time saw movies like Godard or Bergman. But I was there speaking about the fact that seeing movies, I was so fascinated by the fact how they structured reality. For example, that you would see these big close-ups. So if someone say, I love you, you see this big face and it's looking at you, and it feels as if this face is specifically speaking to you and not to anybody else. This was the only film he ever made. And because he got such a lot of criticism on this film, he later also wondered if it was really worth it. It was also censored for many, many years. And this is just a fragment from the beginning to 13 minutes. Okay. Thank you. another thing why Jean Genet was so important for me was that, as I said, I wasn't so pleased, or I was a bit, you know, felt a bit ashamed of being a painter, because I actually, you know, rather thought I should be Jesus Christ or Che Guevara. I wanted to be wise. I wanted to change the world. I didn't want to be a painter, but I also didn't do anything else. I didn't blow up people. So what was very important for me, I read the book that Sartre wrote about Jean Genet, Saint Genet, and Genet always said how, I mean, he was a petty thief. So when he was young and he lived in orphanages and he actually liked being in prison and he liked the eroticism of prison. So he said something once, like, if you are going to be a thief, then be a good thief. It was the sort of existentialist thing that, you know, if that is what you do, then, you know, accept that you do that. And so for a long time, I always wanted to say I'm not an artist because I thought I'm not good enough, but it was more a cop-out. So I always said I'm a student, because as long as I didn't say I was an artist, I could also not be judged on that. And so in a sense, somehow, then at a certain stage, I thought, well, whether I'm good or bad, if that is what I do, I better take the responsibility and say that I do that. And I think he taught me that. Thank you. So we met in 1972 when we both went to Michaela's School of Art, which is part of the university. And he was from a totally different family than mine. I came from the plas, from the boerderij, Afrikaans-speaking people, and he from a whole different... Remember, you talk a bit.
I came from the beach.
Cape Town.
I was from Cape Town, you know, with a kind of affluent Jewish merchants. Most of the Jewish merchants lived by the beach because their family had escaped the Second World War, and they were getting away from Europe, and Marlene's family. So I was a first generation South African. I really had no relationship to the place. I didn't know why I was there even. My father was from Lithuania, my mother was from London, and I was on this beach in Cape Town. So I went surfing, and Marlene was from a real echte Afrikaner
Boere
family.
Mama de France surname, so.
Yeah, I spoke English and Hebrew and French, right? And Marlene and Afrikaans. Luckily, my father was good with languages, so I spoke really good Afrikaans, and I think that's what. Pretty good.
Okay. No, because none of the. At that time, no one wanted to speak Afrikaans because Afrikaans is the oppressors and the wrong language.
And Marlene could not Engels. Wanneer ons was jong, Marlene had an Afrikaans gepraat, had nie in Engels gepraat nie. And the twee van ons had samen Afrikaans gepraat, maar ek het ook baie om Afrikaans te praat. Dan ek dink dis was die eerste rede man ons het was vriendinne.
What was that?
Sorry, wrong tense, vriende.
So when I went to Cape Town University, I thought I could speak English because I knew the films and stuff, but my English was not that good to really do a good exam and everything, so it was a hard time. So when I came to Holland, I thought, well, I can speak Holland. It's Dutch, is a bit like Afrikaans, but it wasn't. So again, I couldn't speak the language, so I've given up. I was just accepted at the ateliers.
You were in a squat.
No, squat came later. And here comes Michael on the boat from London with Dick Jewell, another friend.
That I'd met in London somewhere.
And
this is the punk rock time. It's like 1976, 77.
And I was I didn't know Holland or anything, so I was quite still very unsure. And the two of you, we saw Deep Throat together. That was the first porno movie. They were eating ice cream.
I have to say, I said, Dick, I know this. Dick was a typical Cockney guy, spoke like this. And I said, I was in London. My mother was English, so I knew how to work London well. And I said, I know this really cute blonde girl there. is, South African girl. I went to go there. And the two of us came there. And she and Marlene was there, like with Lucien, right?
Yeah,
living. I remember that you were staying on the floor.
We were staying in Skogrijk in Harlem at that time. You would always tell me, have you met anybody? I've met Andy Warhol, I've met all the people. And I said, I haven't met anybody. And so he always made me feel very jealous and insecure, because he said, I'm now studying semiotics at Columbia University. And what are you doing?
What she was doing was actually doing her work. See, I was being social. Marlene was actually doing her work. So the result is, you can be 25 and being very social and know a lot of famous people, or you can be sitting in Harlem doing your work. So when you're 55, suddenly you've got this whole body of work that you did your whole life, but all the people I was social with are all dead.
Now we're going to see a film of Michael called Island.
The island.
Yeah.
It's a pun on I land, on like, you know.
Yeah. And this is made in the time when Nelson Mandela was considered a terrorist by everyone. He was considered a terrorist for a very long time. But in that time also, no images of him could be shown, and nothing of Robben Island could be shown. So this would. Although Michael's film also concerns language, and there's texts from the Bible, you see all these links, because South Africa has got all those things, always very important how people define things.
This is the first movie I made in America. And what I did was I took a South African government propaganda film that the South African government was still trying to get investment from America into South Africa during apartheid, which they got. I went to the South African government embassy in New York. I was in New York at Columbia, and I ordered a propaganda film. I said I was trying to help them get investment. I took the propaganda film. Now this is in pre-digital, in 16mm. I re-photographed the film on an Oxbury, which was an older analog copy stand. Because I was very technical. I did all myself. I re-photographed the film, and then I got photographs from Robben Island, smuggled photographs, to subvert the film, to deconstruct it, because I was studying with Roland Barthes and all these really heavy guys at the time. That's why I was telling her, who are you studying with? I'm studying with Roland Barthes. Right?
Our first job was breaking stones with a 4-pound hammer. Every day we were taken from our cells into the enclosed yard, and there we sat in the same place week after week. We were evenly spaced out and never permitted to speak to each other. We had to break stones to fulfill a certain quantity of work each day. If not, we were punished at the weekend by the deprivation of 3 meals. We were never allowed to speak on behalf of others. When we made a complaint, it had to be I. But still we said we. Then they wouldn't listen to us. Most prisoners, however, suffer far less from physical abuse than they do from their white jailers' assault. Almost constant psychological assault. For example, South African Prisons Act obliges authorities to allow all inmates to remain in contact with their families. Yet over the years, such communication has been severely restricted. More and more, we have been cut off completely from the outside world. I once received a letter where all that was left was the address of the sender. The entire letter had been cut away. The blank paper between what had been paragraphs held the whole page together, and at one end was the signature of the sender. But that counted as a letter received when I was allowed only one every 6 months.
What I did like of the pun time is the fragmentation of tearing things apart. So the style, the formal style of Johnny Rotten and the guys.
Like the Anarchy, you know, album cover.
What bothered me then a bit about certain type of collage was that I thought you make everything so the same that it doesn't really matter. You don't read anymore the differences. I wanted to, in my collages, make it so that you could read certain aspects. And only much later I read that also with Rauschenberg, sometimes there was, and even later with David Sally, but that's something else again, but there were, these guys also had their sad love stories in their collages, but you just, if you couldn't see it, you didn't know that they were in there.
Me, as a guy and very macho, I looked at it very cold, clinical. That's the problem with this film. Marlene, because of her life and where she'd come from and what had happened, looks at it with sadness and emotion. And I honestly think that's what I've learned from Marlene. Just sitting next to, you know, when you watch a movie in a movie house that you've made, every time you see it through the eyes of the audience. It's an amazing experience as a filmmaker. So if you're sitting next to someone and you're watching it, you completely feel their vibes. As you learn where to, it's amazing. Every filmmaker will always tell you this, that they view every screening through the eyes of the audience.
Well, some don't go in, some don't care.
They all care at one point. At some point when they have a screening, you freak out. And from Marlene, you learn emotion and sadness. I mean, that's really the key to your work, is the emotion, is the ability to put that there. And I think that's always been there, you know? I think that's from the very start. That whole group in New York at that time was, there was Jim Jarmusch, there was Nan Golden, there was, you know, Amos Poe, there were also Yvonne Rainer, there were all sorts of people in New York. And Marlene did come and live with us.
She
stayed, she visited, but I mean, you know, when you came, we had lofts, right? Like, now they cost $20 million a loft, but back then they were $200 a month. And we had that loft, remember?
Anyway, what was interesting is when I thought to do it about the 70s, I always thought, you know, because I'm not Dutch, but, you know, if I didn't stay in Holland, if I did go to New York, would I have, because there was a time where I wanted my checks as a sort of, on extra, how can I say, you know, like Barbara Kruger, But on the other hand, I also like to paint. So, and if I had the text totally like a commercial on top of my painting, it didn't quite work. So I was always torn a bit by liking the Germans in a certain way, and then not liking other aspects, and then liking the Americans for certain things, or feeling more at home with certain aspects, and then the British, which, you know, so. I don't know what would have happened if I would have stayed somewhere else.
Have you seen, this is why Marlene paints and I would never paint, because Marlene can actually draw. And a lot of those artists in New York that are painters, I found out when I got there, couldn't actually draw, really. They would use, you mentioned David Sally, he would project with one of those things, those projection things. I was amazed when we were in art school, you weren't allowed to project onto a canvas and then draw.
I like to project too.
Yeah. Well, you don't.
But I can draw.
She can draw.
There's a painting
that Marlene did of me when I was 18, that is like the portrait of Dorian Gray. It looked like me at 18. You look at it now, it still looks just like me. It's amazing. And I assure you, she was not projecting. So when I was teaching at Columbia University with Catherine Bigelow, we made the class watch a Fassbinder movie every... We had a class that went on for like 3 months, and we taught, and these were the American kids that school were coming to become commercial filmmakers, you know, they wanted to watch whatever, what was it, 1978 was Star Wars, I guess, around there, right? And we made the class watch a Fassbinder movie. Every week, they had to watch one movie, and they hated us, because they were in German, and they had subtitles, and they were slow, they were, you know. Remember, this is like, Fassbinder was also like 76, 77, he was just, you know, he wasn't that much older than us, you know, he was, but he was, you know, he had this fever that lit him up. Fassbinder was a spectacular human being. He was big and fat and crazy like a comet, burning like, wah, right? ultimately, in the end, I think that's how I learned to really make movies later on, because I realized they weren't dealing with this intellectual shit. They were really making movies about people and about contact. Even, you know, and it took me 14 years to process, I'd say, process that stuff.
Fassbinder was a big fan of Douglas Sirk. And here is an obituary for Fassbinder from written by Douglas Sirk, in which he says, "Rainer Werner Fassbinder dead. Today I have lost a good friend and Germany a genius. I would never have thought that the evil day would arrive when I, so much older, would be writing these words of mourning for this 36-year-old man." Because he was quite young and he made sort of 44 films in 14 years or 16 years, sometimes they say.
It never happened before, it will never happen again.
I was looking for this film because also he plays it with his mother. And this relationship of the artist and his mother I found also very interesting.
Sie sind tot. Gerade Enzel und Raspe. Die haben sich umgebracht in ihren Zellen. Sie hat sich aufgehängt und der Bart und der Raspe haben sich erschossen. Weiß ich auch nicht. Pistolen haben sich erschossen. Dass kein Mensch mit die Waffen da reingekommen sind.
Ja, dass die Leute hier begreifen, dass hier bei uns, das sind ja im Grunde die Masse ist ja keine Demokratie. Die haben die Demokratie überhaupt noch nicht kapiert. Die glauben, wenn man Kritik übt an dem Staat, dann ist man schon was weiß ich.
Aber du unterstützt das doch, indem du sagst, du würdest im Moment niemandem empfehlen zu diskutieren.
And I just want to quote a Dutch, Paul Verhoeven, the Dutch director. Die vrijheidsstrijders van die onderdrukten zijn die terroristen van die onderdrukkers. Which just means the freedom fighters of the oppressed are the terrorists of the oppressors. And so, in a sense, we started with Michael's films and about this whole thing. What do you call someone? Also, with some of my paintings, then, you know, someone described the painting, you know, so I said, don't necessarily use the word terrorist, you know, it depends on which side you are on. So all these words are already
ambiguous.
Yeah, and they're not just descriptive, they're very prescriptive words already. So that is something that I have always been very aware of. If you describe a painting or something, or whatever you describe, what is the terms you use? Because in those terms, you already put so much,
That comes from
Michelangelo. Oh, yeah, I just want a little anecdote about German, that my mother came to visit me in only once while I was at the ARTtube, and she didn't really find Holland so exciting, so we took a little trip. So we went to Rome and to Venice. It was a short little trip like that. And then in Rome, we wanted to see an English movie. And there was only one cinema with an English movie, so we didn't know what we were going to see. And we saw Saint Sebastian of Derek Jarman, and the language was Latin. So I have to say that, so that's nice how everything comes back with all these type of things.
But what I wanted to say is a quote from Not End with Jean-Luc Godard, which is that every movie is a documentary of itself being made, and it is this aspect that informs all these movies, is this documentary aspect that even in Jarman, he's showing this 16th or whatever, 18th century queen doing a thing, and she invokes the spirit, and he cuts to it, and it's a Super 8 film in the punk rock era in contemporary time, and it's really just, you know, they're not really acting, they're just being punks. Mm-hmm. But and it crosses over the threshold of, is it good or bad acting?
some of these things that I show now wasn't because I have all seen them then, and then I made works inspired on them. I mean, I wasn't directly, but as you say, like the German, it was our times. So the times did affect you. And yeah, it is in the work, but not always so direct.
It was our youth, and there was a lot of strange, you know, coming out of South Africa, because we didn't have television and the media was censored. We didn't know half, we kind of half knew, but South Africa was its own drama. It was so drama there, and you so had to either be for apartheid or against apartheid. There wasn't a middle ground you could be on if you were really in any way conscious in South Africa, right? You couldn't just sort of skip your way through it. It was an intense place to be, and you were either, you were, you know, taking advantage of the situation, making lots of money, as some people did, or you were an artist and you did not take advantage of the situation. You made some kind of political art, which meant you were an outsider and you made no money. So you wanted to be in touch with the world, so you left because the situation was unbearable. And when you came into the world, it was still the Munich Olympics hadn't happened so many years previously. And there was a real, the terrorists were not the other. The terrorists were us.
Oh, yeah,
that's the difference.
Okay, that might be a good line to
Arab
stop this
people.
Because indeed this whole evening is a bit about indeed who is the terrorist.
Exactly. Okay. And that's what the Paddy Hurst thing was about. Well, okay. I'm not Paddy Hurst, right? Okay. Who is the terrorist?
So yeah, let's see.
Let's there you go.
Thank you very much.
Okay. That was a very good summing up.
Watch for the moon.
da-da-da-da, mango tree behind me. Make boo-loo-loo underneath the mango tree. Make boo-loo-loo soon.
Underneath the mango tree, my honey and me.
Who is that?
It's all right. I'm not supposed to be here either. I take it you're not. Are you alone?
What are you doing here? Looking for shells?
No, I'm just looking.
Stay where you are.
I came from South Africa to study in Holland, and I was all alone in Harlem. The atelier is three and sister who is still in Harlem. And I think that this was part of, I don't know if this was actually part of the best of the erotic film festival, but I remember sitting there all alone in the cinema in Harlem, and I keep everything, as you can see, this is still from there. And apart from being all alone, I have to admit this film, you had all the time the sense of something, there's something going to happen that is, so it wasn't your ordinary sort of erotic or pornographic film. And and the director also said he could never have made it just in Japan. He made a French connection and then he got it made. Anyway, this is so many years later where I used a still from that film. And also what is interesting in the film, and often my films have got women who is quite active, take active roles in the love story, which is not so strange, because I'm a woman too, but I mean, I only analyzed myself also after all these years. I mean, it wasn't that when I did it, I thought, okay, I'm doing it for this reason. But so you look back, indeed, that's what retrospectives are for, and you see the connections, and I have often worked with the thing of giving names or not giving names in love stories. In the main film, Hiroshima Mon Amour, Marguerite Duras wrote the script and the text, and she also made a point that these people, both of them, you will not have their names. They do not have names. And here you have an image from Last Tango in Paris. We'll see a clip from there, but he specifically makes a point to that we don't need names here. And then later, when he does want to tell her name, his name, she doesn't want to know it anymore, and then everything is over and it goes terribly wrong. But this is a very touching scene from there.
Maybe we can come with that touching.
Come without touching? Okay. You concentrating? Did you come yet?
No.
Huh?
It's difficult.
I didn't either yet. You're not trying hard enough.
I shall have to invent a name for you.
Name? Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh, God, I've been called by a million names all my life. I don't want a name. I'm better off with a grunt or a groan for a name. Do you want to hear my name?
It's a masculine.
Yeah.
Listen to mine.
I didn't get the last name.
Just a few weeks ago or so, I saw documentary on Marlon Brando, and there they said, and I never knew that, they said that his father was alcoholic, his mother was alcoholic, and he was dyslexic, and so he had trouble also with remembering texts, and that he really wanted the mother to care much more for him and to find him a good person and to give him lots of credit. And he often had to get her out of the bar and stuff like that, and that apparently, and she then was very depressed and all that, and apparently to make her laugh, he made animal sounds, because that made her laugh or smile. And I thought that was very touching, because I wondered maybe he wrote that in about the thing of not making the sounds instead of identifying yourself with the men. This was for me important work too. It's called Tederheid in de derde persoon, tenderness of the third person. And there I directly used three clips from films. The one is from Sunday Bloody Sunday, Peter Finch, and I forgot his name now. The two of them together, and then you have here from Hiroshima Mon Amour, and you have there Sir Gainsbourg with his partner at the time, Jane Birkin, directing her with a man that I always found very sexy, Joe D'Alessandro. But he was always in Andy Warhol films. Because Birkin is so androgynous, he then, they start this relationship. So, and there's even a strange role for Gerard Depardieu in this film. And so it's, well, I found it very erotic between these two, because I also like androgynous people. So you have this Birkin, and then there's a, but it's also sad because in the end he does go back to his male lover because she dresses up in a dress, and that it's not only that, but that also didn't quite do it. But I haven't seen it again, but then found it a very erotic and also always a bit sad love story because he leaves, and. Okay, now we go to another tragic character, called Spectre. I didn't realize that a lot of the pop songs of my youth was actually works that he produced, because you have those songs like And Then I Kissed or so, and you have the Runettes, and you have a lot of the songs that was all really songs that he did. And then when he, a song that, that I also didn't know was his, which I always thought was very beautiful, was because to know him is to love him, and I do. And apparently he, talking about different type of couples, he wrote it for his father. He didn't write it for a man or for a woman, he wrote it. And the father apparently, that's not the point, but committed suicide, or maybe it was committed suicide quite early or so. But he has made such beautiful songs, but in the end, He ended up in jail because he was supposed to murder this woman. So, and then for my 50th birthday, I got this as a present, this film where Al Pacino is playing Phil Spector.
For what am I being punished? For being the most successful music producer in the history of the world.
Did you kill that girl?
I think he is not guilty.
First time you got felt up, guess what? You were listening to one of my songs.
You think I shot the girl?
What can I do to defend him?
The prosecution is going to do everything in its power to break you.
You defend me?
If you get him off, what will you do when he kills the next girl?
I know what this is costing you.
This is a rehearsal.
You have testified she had the gun in her mouth. I screamed.
No.
They kill men for telling the truth.
They let OJ go. They let Michael Jackson go. They are not going to let him go.
That's why, you fucking murderer!
Did you kill Lana Clarkson?
Why would I kill that girl? Why?
If you go off like that,
you're going to jail for the rest of your life.
I've played this game a million times before. I know how the game is played.
I just want to say, because it's that when one looks back and you see the links, then everything looks sometimes very logical, although I didn't bring it in a very logical way, maybe, but people also ask me, why did I paint Amy Winehouse at this stage? But when I started to follow the trial of Phil Spector, and also, I also always wanted to have a wig. I do have a bit of a wig. And so I like people with wigs. Phil Spector's got wigs, and Andy Warhol's got wigs. And so I really got into the Phil Spector story, but then Julie, who works with me, Julie said to me, I don't know Phil Spector, and I also don't know this song. So she was looking up the song To Know Him Is to Love Him, and she found Amy Winehouse singing his song. It was a B-side of one of her. And then it was at the time where she had just died. So this sort of, these two trans people, I mean, this came together. Now we're going to see a bit from real life, but indeed, I think it was John Ford, the filmmaker, who said, if you have facts and you have a myth, go for the myth when you make a film. But here you see real life, and they all look so fake that the Al Pacino looks totally like Phil Spector.
Jesse Steinberger, you've had celebrity clients. So look, we all know that celebrity clients tend to be a little different than the average bear, but this is pretty unbelievable stuff that I was reading. Agree or disagree?
Ashley, it's different stuff, and that's why you're covering it. This is a Hollywood trial. This is what they indicted him for. And you know, you're talking about the guy being belligerent and yelling and using expletives. It doesn't make him a murderer. It just doesn't make him a murderer. And the more you try and push
now
the
I do. And I do. Oh, I'll be good to him. I'll bring joy to him. Oh, everyone says there'll come a day when I walk alongside of him. No, him is to love. And I do, I really do, and I do. Because of him, I'll bring joy to him. Oh, everyone says there'll come a day when I walk alongside of him. No, him is to love. And I do. I really do. I do.
When I was at at art school in South Africa, there was a film society, and I've mentioned that before, that in South Africa at that time, the visual arts, the paintings, it's always very non-existing or not very interesting at all. Theatre was political, and literature was also dealing with the real world. This film society, there I saw this film for the first time, Woman of the Dunes, and my lecturer spoke about, because we were all thinking, you know, do you stay in South Africa, do you leave, what do you do with your life, what is your destiny, is there something like destiny, is there something like free will? And this film, this man tries all the time to get out of this hole. And the sand keeps on falling, and he wants to get away from the woman, away from the hole, and get back to the normal life. And it is a love story. There's violence, there's bun up, I mean, desperation and everything in it. But basically, the sand keeps on falling, and if you want to survive, you have to keep on doing the same thing all the time, and he has to stay with this person he wants to. Yes, well, it was very important for me also thinking about what is life, what choices do you make. Okay, so it's a fragment from this film, it's a longer fragment.
Thank you.